Yo, MVP! Let's go!
All of my life, I've never known you to fail. You remain the same and wonderful is your name.
Thank you. What's up to my Potter's House family? It's your boy, Ty Galbraith, and I am so, so excited to be coming to one of the greatest houses of worship in the world, the Potter's House Dallas, to be worshiping with you guys. I'm believing that God is gonna show up in an amazing way, that this church, your church, is an amazing place to be bringing encounter nights. I'm calling it encounter nights and not a tour, because it's not a tour. Because a tour never changed anyone's life. But an encounter is the reason why you're sitting where you're sitting. The reason why I'm standing where I'm standing is because I encountered Jesus and it changed my life forever. Today, go over to toddgalbraith.com. Get your tickets while they last. I'm believing it's going to be a sold-out night. We also have some VIP tickets. We want to come shake hands and meet and greet you, get you some preferred seating. So please go over today to toddgalbraith.com, get your tickets, and I cannot wait to encounter Jesus with you. See you guys soon.
Your praise hair and your praise feet and all of that ready for this Sunday morning. We hope that you came with your expectation. Asia, let's get right into these announcements.
All right.
Because these next few weeks, we got a lot of stuff going on. We need you to know so that you can be here and be a part. All right?
Yes.
So first things first, I hope you guys have been here and been a part of, whether in person or online, our Wednesday nights with our bishop, Bishop Joby, Brady, our life classes. Listen, this Tabernacle series.
Yes.
I got to actually jump in on, like, on the inside, in service a couple of weeks ago. Oh, my gosh. I love him. I love his teaching.
Yes.
Be here Wednesday night, 6:45. Be on time.
Yes. And then bowling night with TPHND singles. So we're going to Penn Stack Allen. If you are single, ready to mingle, come bowl, get some strikes, March 31st. So that is this upcoming Friday from 7 to 9. There's going to be a QR code for you to register. It's probably a booth if you have any questions. Also coming up this Saturday is first Saturday. So that means we're having Saturday morning prayer. We're going to all meet here at 7 a.m., get here, we're going to pray, and then after that, we're going to keep going. We're going to be healthy all around, not just spiritually, but physically. So we have Fit Fam. Yes. So come ready to work out, ready to sweat. So you have prayer at 7, Fit Fam at 8:30.
And just because you go to Fit Fam at 8:30 on Saturday morning does not mean you don't come to church Sunday morning
and give him the good praise yes.
that you just worked out. Right?
Keep it going.
Okay,
Saturday, Sunday.
Going. Saturday, back to back. Sunday. And then in concert on April 5th, Wednesday, April 5th, as you just saw the video, Ty Galbraith is going to be here.
Yes.
There is a code TPH15 to save 15%. Now, that's just for family. And if you're watching
that's
the stream,
us.
That means you family. So make sure that you use the code and get your 15% off and be in the building.
Yes, and then we got more stuff.
More?
So this Saturday, we got prayer.
Okay.
We got Fit Fam. Next Saturday, bring all the kiddos. We have our Easter extravaganza. So we've got our Easter egg hunt. We're going to have lots of fun and family with our family. So 11 to 1, it's a family event. So you can invite people from the community. It is a free event. Food, giveaways, face paint. Bring your kids. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Did you say food?
Food, yes.
I'll be there.
Food.
Great.
We all love food.
That is Saturday, April the 8th. The next day, Easter Sunday.
Wait, we need volunteers. If you love kids, come volunteer. We need volunteers. We need you. So sign up.
I'm going to sign up.
Sign up.
Volunteer.
You going to come
with
the
kids? I'm going to volunteer. I'm going to help with the kiddos.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to go home and go to take a nap.
Okay. All right. That's fine.
The next day, Sunday, April the 9th, is Easter Sunday, that great getting up morning. You have to be in the building. Two services, 8 a.m. and there's no child care on that one. And 10 a.m., there will be child care.
Yes.
Be there. Don't miss on Easter Sunday. Okay, that's all I have to say about that.
You got to come to Easter.
And last but not least, really quickly, Engage Saturday, April 15th at 10 a.m., with none other than Dr. Ooh. Jermone Glenn.
Yes. Y'all, you remember he was here. He was great.
It's going to be great. Listen, it's time to go into worship. If you're at home watching us, or if you're at work, kind of lift your hands up. Stand up. Join with us in worship. Let's go. Enjoy your Sunday.
Happy Sunday.
Good morning, church. Good morning. Good morning. Put your hands together and bless the Lord this morning. Just you being here is a sign that God is still good, that he's still on the throne, that he sits high and looks low, that he cares about us, that he's given us another chance to get it right, another chance to praise and worship. We're going to have a good time this morning in the Lord. Come on, let's set the atmosphere. Let the Lord know that he's welcome. God, you're welcome to sit in this church. You're welcome to come sit beside me. God, be my neighbor this morning. Take over my role this morning. Do something you've never done before, because I'm going to give you a praise like never before. How many of y'all come with the spirit of expectation this morning? Come on, show some sign. I expect God to do just what he said he will do. He is a keeper of his word. He said he's a deliverer. He said he's a friend. We are conquerors through him. We can do all things. God, we stand on your word this morning, and we come to give you praise. Are you with me this morning? Come on, come on. I'm not by myself. I know I'm not. Yes, church, lift it up. We're going to have a good time this morning. Yeah. Let's go. Come on.
Full of wonder, our God. driving to in this moment. When I look at where my feet stand, I'm amazed at the sovereignty of God. It was only your grace and your mercy that could have kept me and brought me this far. So you get the glory.
Oh, morning, God. We present our bodies as a living sacrifice. You get the glory. Woo! Oh, that should be your prayer, your heart's cry this morning. Say you get the glory. Say all the glory. All the glory. All the glory. Say you get the glory. All the glory. Yeah, all the glory. Hallelujah. Everybody say, you get the glory. Come on now, don't just sing about it. But can we give it to him? I mean, reach deep down and just give God the highest praise that you have this morning. Give him the highest praise that you have this morning. He's so worthy. Our God is sovereign and he reigns. He's in control. The Bible tells us that he sits high, but thanks be unto God, y'all, he looks low too. Because it was in some of my lowest moments that his arm reached down and lifted us, God. Can you testify this morning? It's been nothing but you, Jesus. It's been nothing but your mercy. Oh, things that I did not deserve. It's been nothing but your grace. When I look back over my life, I have to say it's nothing but your grace that's kept us. Has he kept you through anything? I know you may not look like that this morning, because God has been good to you, I can tell. But if you let your mind wander just back a few weeks ago, or even a few months ago, or even just a few years ago, we wouldn't believe what God has done in your life. If you were to tell us now what he did then, we may not believe you. But how many of you know that we serve a miracle-working God? Oh, we serve a God who can wash us. We serve a God who can lift us up out of the darkness, out of depression, out of low self-esteem. He's called us out of anxiety. He's calling us out of sickness. This is the type of God that we serve. And some people wonder why we get up on a Sunday morning, on one of our only 2 days off, and enter his gates with thanksgiving. And we choose to come before the Lord singing praises. We are thankful unto him. Is anybody thankful this morning? We're thankful unto him. And we will bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. Hey. And his mercy endures forever. Y'all didn't hear me. Let me declare it in your hearing this morning. For the Lord is good. Hey. I know it may look bad right now. For the Lord is good. You may not know how this thing is going to turn out for you. For the Lord is good. And it ain't over until it's good. You ought to put a praise right there. Hope and trust in the Lord this morning. Because it's not over until it's good. Stand still this morning and see the salvation of the Lord. Hey, you don't have to fight in your own strength. You just gotta praise. You don't have to work it out in the flesh. You just gotta reach up in the spirit and pull down every stronghold with your praise. Somebody sing Judah first this morning. You might be facing a battle, but this battle belongs to the Lord. You might be facing a diagnosis, but this battle belongs to the Lord. Hey, he's our maker. He's our keeper. He's our sustainer. Oh, he's our help. This is why we come into the house of the Lord. There's no other help we know. No other help we know. Jesus, we bless you this morning. Family, we serve a mighty good God. Come on and clap your hands one more time. We serve a mighty, 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 mighty God. He's the Lord God, strong and mighty. Oh, you can't talk about him like that. and him not come into the room. He's the Lord God, strong and mighty. The Lord God, mighty in battle. Whatever you're facing or have faced or whatever even you feel like chase you into the sanctuary today, know that you have a God. And he sits on the throne. All right? He sits on the throne. He sits on the circle of the earth. And how blessed are we that he wants to hear from us. Think about that. How blessed are we that such a holy God would want to hear us say, Lord, I thank you. Lord, I praise you. Lord, I worship you. My heart is yours this morning. The angels worship him. They cry holy. Oh, but we get to cry everything else too. We get to say, Lord, if it had not been for you. They don't got that testimony. This is our testimony. And truly, it's a privilege to bless him this morning. Well, family, it's tithe time in the sanctuary. It sounds like there's some cheerful givers in here. I mean, somebody who is glad to be a giver. Someone who God is trusting so that we can advance his kingdom. I want to ask you to prepare your tithe this morning, whether you're here in the sanctuary or you're an e-member or you're joining us online this morning. This is just a continuation of our worship. We not only bring him our song, we not only bring him our thanks, but we bring him what belongs to him. The Bible tells us that the tithe is the Lord's. Make no doubt about it, guys. Malachi is super, super clear, right? The tithe is the Lord's, and he instructs us to bring that tithe. Well, let me just go back. What is a tithe? I don't want to assume that everybody understands that in this room today. A tithe is simply a tenth of our increase. It is 10% of whatever the Lord has brought into our lives, into our homes, into our families this week. And as covenant keepers and believers and disciples of Christ, we have made that decision to give God what belongs to him. We don't tip God. We don't tip. We tithe. Tell somebody, I'm not just a tipper. I'm a tither. I understand the power of the covenant that I have with him. How incredible that he would make a way that we could be in covenant with him. And I'm so grateful for that this morning. So we rip off and we tear off 10% of our increase, and we cheerfully bring it into the house of the Lord. You know why we're cheerful about it? Because we know that when we plant good seed in good ground, there will be a great harvest. How many of you can testify that I am reaping in areas I didn't even see coming? I mean, I have seen God do some things in my life and in my family in the last 2 weeks that I would have laughed. I would have just chuckled if you would have told me whatever has transpired in my life. Just if you would have told me this last year, would have been tickled. But let me tell you something. That's the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And I know that as we continue to make that decision to make him a priority, listen, I prioritize savings. I prioritize paying Uncle Sam. I prioritize putting money back for investments. I prioritize putting money away for vacation and family time. But there is not one thing that I prioritize more than bringing my tithe into the storehouse. Oh, come on. This is something that is full of promises. As we bring it, I want you to lift up your tithe right now. If you don't have an envelope, you need one. There should be one in the seat pocket in front of you. Or our incredible greeters are here to serve you. Many of you always give on your phone, so you feel free to do that today. But I want to pray over you. And as I get ready to pray over you, I want to just remind you, and I know many of you have been watching the news and you saw the complete devastation that came to Mississippi and Alabama. And I think the last count that I saw late last night was, you can put your hand down for 1 second. I know that this right here was starting to burn, and I don't want no spirit of distraction to hit you right now. But so much devastation has happened. I mean, roofs literally ripped off homes, neighborhoods completely decimated. And we have, there's a pastor friend of ours, Pastor Morgan. He's a local pastor in this community, a great partner with us. Not only his mother, but his mother-in-law have suffered just crazy amounts of damage in their homes there
in Mississippi and Alabama. We also have some church members who have family who's been there and been affected. This week, you all, we want to be a blessing. We don't know what all the need is, but listen, look at that. You saw it. You see that there's a need. We want to continue to be the hands and the feet of Jesus. As you bring your tithe into the storehouse, yes, God blesses you, and he covers you, and he keeps you and sustains you. But how many know it's more than just what God does for us? He's blessing us and raising us up to be a blessing. And so as you are faithful to bring your tithe into this house and your offering into this house is faithful to be good stewards over what comes in. And one of the ways that we can do that is not only in our local community, but when things like this happen, we can send help. So I want to thank you this morning. As you sow, I want to let you know that your seed does not just stay in this ground, but it goes out and it accomplishes what it needs to accomplish. Can you clap your hands for every seed sower in this room? And now can you clap them and thank him for the covenant that you have as a giver, as a believer, as a tither, as a seed sower? Father, we thank you for that today. Let's pray. I'm going to pray over you. You can just lift your phone, lift your hand. And if you don't have anything to give yet, you don't have anything in your pocket to give today, you stand too. Because we want to pray over you, because we are believing that this will be the last time that you are in this position. He says, I give seed to the sower. So the Lord sees your heart today, and he knows that you want to be a giver. You want to contribute. You want to make a difference. So today, this prayer is for you and your house as well. Father, we just thank you this morning. It is in moments like this that we remember and we realize that everything that we have comes from you. Everything that we have, it belongs to you. So as your children this morning, Lord, in this precious moment of worship, we give to you what belongs to you. Not last, but we put you first, Lord. We put you first in our finances because we want you to be first in everything that we say and do. Lord, because your word tells us so many great things, but one of the things that it tells us, that if we would seek you first, put you first, Lord, you would add everything that we need. And there are so many testimonies and living witnesses around this room and watching online this morning that we have seen time and time again as we have been faithful to do what you have called us to do, God. Lord, you just keep making ways where there seems to be no way. You keep opening doors this week, right now, open doors. This family comes together and stands in agreement with each other this morning for open doors for our brothers and our sisters. Whoever is in here that is in need of a job this week, open doors. Declare that right now, open doors. Lord, whoever needs increase, even in their salary, and it just looks like they're gonna get denied again, right now, say increase. Increase over my brothers, increase over my sisters, increase in their creativity and witty ideas. Lord, we thank you even for new clientele. Who needs new clientele in here? Father, we thank you that this week you are bringing new clientele to our businesses. God, because we know that you want us to be blessed so that we can be a blessing, Lord. Not to hoard up for ourselves, God, but to help you establish your kingdom right here in earth. And in Frisco, Texas, what a privilege it is to worship you, not just with our song, but with our resources today. In Jesus' name, we pray. Everybody said, amen. Come on, givers, clap your hands and rejoice in our God. If you have a seed in an envelope that you want to bring down to the front as we prepare to go further in worship, I want you to go ahead and just get out of your seat and say, excuse me. You can bring your sacrifice, you can bring your tithe and lay it on the altar this morning. Our incredible deacons are here to serve you, and the rest of you can just remain standing. We're getting ready to go to the word of the Lord. Will you welcome Pastor Joseph this morning?
Can you clap your hands for Pastor Tina? She's got a mighty, mighty, mighty anointing on her life. She's so soft-spoken, but don't play with her because she'll cast out a devil in a minute. Don't mess with her. I remember the first time I held Josiah when I was younger. I didn't like to hold babies before they could control their neck. I didn't have kids yet, and I wasn't going to be liable. If you can't control your own neck, don't get in my hands. And so I had a rule. I waited till about 6 months before I held babies because that's just the way that I operated. I was sitting on the platform in Durham at the river, and somebody got to manifesting in the balcony. And Tina said, hold this baby. I said, who? The next thing I knew, she was up the stairs and on her way to the balcony to deal with the demon. She may be soft-spoken, but she's powerful. Can you clap your hands for Pastor Tina? Clap your hands for all of our pastors. Pastor Travis, we're so glad you're here this morning. Pastor Lana, Pastor Tina, Pastor Jeremy. Can you clap your hands for our bishop and pastor? Pastor Sheryl Brady and Bishop Joby Brady. Pastor Brady wants you to know that she loves you. She's in Chicago this morning on assignment. Amen. On assignment. And Bishop Brady is in Atlanta on assignment. Yes. Amen. They just spread out all over the country, but we are yet here. And because she is out this morning, she's a good mama. You know, good mamas, they'll meal prep in advance. They have little stuff tucked away in the freezer and just put that out in the morning. You gotta set the chicken out, right? It's been some of y'all major whoopings in life because you didn't set that chicken out before. And this was before text message. You had a little note sitting on the table. Get the chicken out. She didn't leave us chicken this morning. She left us some good bread. Yeah. Fresh bread on the table. I want you to open your hearts. We're going to go deeper in worship in just a second, but I want you to open your hearts. Many of you have heard Bishop Godbee before, and some of you may have not. If you have not, you are in for a treat. He's going to get up here talking all deep and low at first, but just wait. Don't. I call it my brother Bishop. And he hails from, at this point, Durham, North Carolina. He's pastoring the river. Yeah. That's the church that our bishop and pastor planted. He's taking it to a whole nother level. They just got a new building. He might tell y'all about it, but he's the prelate of the River Fellowship International. He's an author. He's a speaker. He's a husband. He's married to the amazing Carla Godbee. And they got some amazing children, Kendall, Ron Jr. and Carrington, and I just want us to prepare our hearts to receive what God is about to do in this place. After we finish this song, the next voice you're going to hear is Bishop Godbee, and I want you to be ready for what God is about to say to us. If you're ready, can you lift your hands all over the room and say, God, I'm ready to receive.
I'm ready to receive.
I'm ready to receive. I'm ready to receive.
Yes.
My heart is in need of a word. I it's not that I live in absence of a word, but God, I know that you can say one thing in this moment and change everything for me. You can speak one word to all of us and speak something to each individual all at the same time. So I'm trusting you to do what only you can do. I'm trusting you to use this moment to change my life. My heart is open because this is a house that understands that miracles take place as we worship God. So we lift our hands and we give you glory. Oh, this is a house of worship.
Yes, it is.
This is a house of praise. Where every demon trembles. Where we proclaim your name. This is a house of peace. I hear you, church. Our hearts are full of praise. You have our full attention. You have the final say. So come alive in the name.
Come alive. This is a house of praise. Oh, Lift your hands and begin to release worship all in the room. Come on, this is where your voice goes. This is where you put your faith in the room. This is where you set the backdrop for everything that you've been believing for. And the sound of your worship equals the size of your expectation. And if you could just lift up a loud sound of expectation, I believe that before we leave here, everything that you came in believing God for, you could seal it right now in a sound. Come on, I need you to lift up some expectancy in the room. Come on, I need you to lift up something that says, I believe that God can do it. Come on, Potter's House, lift up a sound that can set your children free. There's a sound in this room that can heal bodies. There's a sound in this room that can regulate minds. I need you before the word comes to lift up some expectation. And I need you to act like you believe God. I said, I need you to act like you believe God. I need you to give God a rousing round of applause. Like if God don't do it, it will not be done. Somebody's pulling heaven down in the earth. You ain't even gonna have to wait for you to get out of service. God sent me to tell you it's happening right now. Just touch three people and tell them it's happening right now. Come on, I need you to move something in the room. Tell somebody it's happening right now. Miracles, signs, and wonders.
Right now, right now. Woo! Right now, right now. Hey, hey. Right now, right now. Woo! Right now.
Oh, oh. Don't wait for the battle to be over, but I dare you to shout right now. Don't wait for the email. I need you to put a praise. Don't wait till you open the mailbox. I need you to put a praise right here. Don't wait till you get the phone call. I need you to shout
right now, right now. Hey, hey, hey.
My God, I feel something moving on this side of the room. I feel something happening for somebody right now. I dare you to make the devil a liar and open up your mouth. And if somebody in the middle could join them, if somebody on this side could join them, I believe that collectively, let the redeemed of the Lord say, do you know you can speak and it's got to move? You can open up your mouth and something's got to change. Let the redeemed of the Lord put your... It's getting better for somebody already. You feel your help right there. You feel your strength coming back. You feel your joy coming back.
Hey, hey. Woo.
Lift your hands all around this room. Just put your voice in the room. Come on, put your sound in the room. Put your worship in the room. Amen. Can you clap your hands and give God praise? Man, before you're seated in the presence of God, can you clap your hands for two of the greatest leaders on the planet? Bishop Joby Brady, Pastor Sheryl Brady. Come on, we can do just a little bit better than that. Let's be a committee of one and let's celebrate them with everything that is within us. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of God. Amen. You know the health and you know the magnitude of a ministry, and you can measure it not when the leader is present, but you can measure it when the leader is absent. And certainly this is reflective of the health and the maturity of this house. Amen. Praise God. Somebody point your hands towards the woman of God and say, it won't always be like this. Come on, if you know what it's like to cry out to God, I need somebody to shout, it won't always. Just tell three people it's about to turn. It's about to turn. Can you just point at somebody and sing that to them? On your way down, clap your hands if you receive it. Amen. I see some of y'all don't know what to do, but that's a good place to put a praise right there. That's a good place to holler. That's a good place to let the devil know, after all I've been through, sooner than later. Tell somebody there's a shift in the room there. Some of y'all waiting for me to preach you up on it, but you better catch hold to that thing. Because before God releases a word, he can release a shift. Ooh, I feel like I'm at home. Tell somebody before the word, I feel a shift. Ooh. Oh. Tell somebody things are about to get better. Things. Some of y'all waiting for it to get better, but there's a word in your belly that can make it better. Tell somebody you ain't gotta wait when you can make it get better. When you can speak to the north, south, east, and the west. When you recognize the God-given authority on the inside of you
You can speak a word and you can shift it just. Don't you do that, Joseph.
Oh, better.
Don't you shout like that, Pastor Joseph. But if I could get 30 more people to holler with him. Something just broke open for you. I said something just broke open for you. You just opened doors and you just opened heavens when you shouted like that.
Be seated in the presence of God if you can. I wish I could sing like Pastor Joseph, but that's not my gift. Amen. Praise God. What an honor and what a privilege it is to be in this place, to be amongst the elite and the elect, to know that God has kept us for such a time as this. What a mighty God we serve. You know, the older that I get, and I'm getting older, amen. I've got a young son who dresses me, so don't let the smooth taste fool you. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of God, but I'm getting older. And the older that I get, I'm not asking God why he takes. I'm asking him why he gives. I marvel in the fact that God graces me with moments like this. It causes me to reflect and say, God, why me? Why would you give me such a wonderful life to be surrounded by so many amazing people? And I want you to know that you're sitting around the best today. You ought to just look to your left and right, marvel, and just praise God that you get to sit next to who you sit next to. You do know that you are seated next to the materialized, manifested mind of God, spoken into the earth, brought forth with purpose, spoken on purpose, and manifested for a purpose. You're not looking for the answer. You sit next to the answer. Just tell your neighbor, when I sit next to you, I sit next to my answer. And sometimes we just need to marvel at how meticulous God is in artfully contriving and composing every detail of our life. There are moments that we just need to step back and say, why me? Why have you been this good to me? I'm in a place in my life again where God just keeps amazing me. And when I look at moments like this, I'm just in awe of God. I thank God for the privilege of being in this place. I, like you, am disappointed that my pastor is not here. I was hoping she was playing a game and she just was going to give me the mic and then she was going to show up and preach. For certainly this house is not at a deficit of preachers. You have preachers par excellent in every person who touches the mic in this place. Amen. But somehow it has befallen my lot to be here with you today. Can I be honest? I come to the Potter's House not because I want to preach here. I come because I've got so many family and friends in this place, and it's a free way for me to see y'all. Amen. So that's the only reason I'm here. I'm really not here to preach. I'm just here to see my family. And so many of you are family and friends, and man, the life that we've done together and the memories that we share and the opportunity to be with you is always my pleasure. I love you, Miriam. It's so good to see you. Really, my favorite of the favorites is Ken's, and that's who I really come to hang out with so I can learn about the new kicks and the new sneakers. She keeps me fresh, but that's my dude right there. I love you so much, and I am so proud of you, so grateful for you. Amen. And all of these wonderful, wonderful friends and family, and what an honor it is to be with you. I'm not going to belabor the time. I want you to open your Bibles to Genesis 41. I have the daunting task of covering a couple chapters. Yeah, I said what I said. A couple chapters. We ain't going to be here that long, but it may take a minute. But in an overarching view of Genesis 38 through 41, I really want to land in Genesis 41. And I want to speak some things in your hearing that I really believe God has purposefully put me in this moment to plan into your life. Verse number 41 of Genesis 41, and Potiphar said to Joseph, "See, I've set you over all the land of Egypt." Then Pharaoh took his signet ring off his hand and put it on Joseph's hand. And he clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. And he had him ride in the second chariot which he had, and they cried out before him and bowed the knee. So he set him over all the land of Egypt. Pharaoh also said to Joseph, "I am Pharaoh, and without your consent, no man may lift his hand or foot in all the land of Egypt." And Pharaoh called Joseph's name Zaphnath-Paneah. And he gave him his wife, Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On. So Joseph went out over all the land of Egypt. Joseph was 30 years old when he stood before Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went throughout all the land of Egypt. Now in the seven plentiful years, the ground brought forth abundantly. So he gathered up all the food of the 7 years which were in the land of Egypt, and laid up the food in the cities, and he laid in every city the food of the fields which surrounded them. Joseph gathered very much grain as the sand of the sea until he stopped counting, for it was immeasurable. And to Joseph were born two sons. To Joseph was born two sons before the year of the famine came, whom Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, bore to him. Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh. God has already blessed and shall continuously bless the reading and the hearing of his word for the edification of our soul. And the people of God said, amen. It is not normally my preaching pattern to select a topic for the sermonic serenade that God has selected to bring before us. But because I want to be a good steward of this moment, I think that it only appropriate that I select one. And for the few moments that we share, I simply want to say, God help me forget. Somebody just lift your voice and say, God help me forget. I'm extremely inquisitive, and my mind thinks in sort of a little different direction. Peculiar would be possibly a good way of describing how I approach the text. There's some tension in this text, of course, and a good preacher always raises the tension in the text. They not only raise the tension, but by the end of the sermon, they resolve it. I'm not sure that I can do a good job resolving, but I do need to raise some tension in the text. Before I raise the tension in the text, I really got to tell you something that's problematic for me. Something that's extremely problematic about the Bible. Never heard a bishop say that there's something problematic about the Bible, but let me express my peculiarity in showing you what's problematic about the Bible. Pastor Travis, it's not the synoptic problem. It's not a problem with Daniel and his prophecies. It's not Isaiah and the things that people have found problematic about the presentation of him being a prophet. It's not the patriarchal narrative and how some believe that it's simply a myth. It's not the Genesis flood account that some feel is an overblown version of the ancient story that's being told. It's not the JEPD theory, the documentary hypothesis of the Pentateuch. But my problem is that the Bible has pages. I see you don't think like I think. But it's problematic that the Bible has pages because in the flip of a page, we can go from Genesis 38 to Genesis 41. In about 13 minutes of perusing this particular pericope and passage, we can go from pit to Pharaoh's house. In the flipping of a page, we can just bypass the process and get straight to the outcome. We can see in a season and a snapshot 13 years of a journey. The audacity of us as believers to just simply flip a page and believe that we understand the entire process that Joseph has gone through. This journey is qualified in just a few pages. And we own this, and we believe that every instant is absent of process. We as believers approach life the way we approach the pages of the Bible. We believe that instantaneously we go from prophetic utterance to manifestation. It's in this text that the tension is raised for us to understand that it's a journey that's not always joyous. Now, I know somebody sitting next to you, they got their Holy Ghost halo hovering over their head. If you let them tell it, they're just enjoying the journey with Jesus. But if they would remove their halo and had just a moment of honesty and transparency, they would say that the journey is a beast. Any real people in here can be like, man, that journey. It's not always joyous. It's not always the destination. But it's this journey that's whipping my behind right now. You know, I know some of you are bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, and you got your rose-colored glasses on, and you just really want to believe that every day with Jesus gets sweeter than the day before. But some of us can be honest and say, man, there's some bitter days mixed in amongst the sweet days. And there are some times that I'm tempted to lean more towards the problematic places that I find myself postured and positioned in. And sometimes that is the thing that becomes the primary focal point of my life, because it's not always the end outcome that really is the thing that resonates in my heart. So for some of us, the journey has wiped us out. Some of you, while others were singing, shouting, and dancing, you were sitting there, and that's not because you don't love Jesus, it's just that the journey is getting the best of you. Have you ever been there before when everybody else was praising God and you were sitting there absent of the experience because the journey was taking your praise away? Has life ever spoke louder than you than the thing that you were believing God for, and you were tempted to surrender and settle and soak and settled into the place of the thing that was problematic around you? It was getting all the attention. I know that there's some, because for us at the River, 2023 is our year to dream again. And the reason that we dubbed it and labeled the year to dream again is because we dreamed before, but something derailed the dream. And I came to talk to some people in Texas that have dreamed before, but life started interrupting your dream. The process made you opt out of your dream, because it's easy to celebrate the outcome, but it's not the outcome that is problematic, it's the income. It's what it takes from you to get to the thing that you aspire to reach for. It's what it drains and draws from you. It's what it pulls from you. And so the dream is not always the thing that I'm celebrating, because it's the dream that you've actualized that serves others, but sometimes you feel like you're the sacrifice and not the success. Have you ever been there before where people were looking at you declaring how successful you are, but you were really feeling more sacrificial than successful? I mean, if they only knew what it took to be you. Can you just nudge somebody and tell them, if you only knew what it took? You know, people will size you up and they will believe that you are in the season of your life. But that's the public presentation. If you only knew my private struggles, if you only knew what I deal with and battle with daily, you wouldn't be talking about me. You'd probably be praying for me. Can you just nudge your neighbor and tell him, spend more time praying for me? Spend more time, because I've arrived, but I'm still broken. I'm blessed, but I still got some baggage. I've got a ring, I've got a robe, and I got a chain, but I still got some challenges. Have you ever been there before? I know everybody can't be honest, but can I get a few honest people in the Potter's House, North Dallas, to say that it's not all that it's cracked up to be? Now, you know, in this generation, when you start providing the real reality of how things really are, they act like you hating on them and don't want them to get nowhere. But the truth of the matter is, to get anything, it may cost you everything. I know that y'all didn't want to hear that. I know that you expected me to say something a more, little more celebratory, but there are seasons in your life that you can have a ring, robe, a chain, and you can be riding in the second chariot, and people can believe that you are on the ride of your life. But they don't have a clue as to the places that you've been betrayed in. They don't understand the difficulties that you've had to deal with. They don't understand the moments and the seasons that it seemed like you were left for dead. Anybody in here can be honest and be like, man, the process has been a whole problem. Amen. There are days that I've been in pits because my brothers betrayed me. There are days that I finally settled into Miss Potiphar's house only for her to betray me. And then I finally maturated to a place that I believed that this was the place that everything was going to manifest, only to be forgotten in the prison. So you see my moments, but you don't understand my process. Somebody just shout at your neighbor and tell them, understand my process. Yeah, I'm in my now moment because God has a way of providing now moments. But some of us make it to our now moment only to discover that we're still numb. We make it to our Kairos moment, but it's the chaos that we've gone through to make it to the Kairos that has convoluted our thinking and clouded our minds. And here we are. I need you to delve into the depths of the life of Joseph and discover that sometimes miracles are made up of messy realities. We celebrate and we shout about the miracle, and we celebrate about the Kairos, and we talk about the seasons of manifestation, but manifestation comes through messy places. And sometimes we have encounters, but they don't erase or eradicate the things that have been etched in us that have traumatized us as we have gained our trajectory in life. It's hard to grow in dirt and not get dirty. It's hard to grow in a dark place and not be consumed by the darkness. It's hard to be cultivated in dung and not come out just a little stinky. I know that y'all don't believe that because you're so saved, sanctified, and full of the Holy Ghost that you believe that just because God saves you from a situation that he etches, he eradicates the things that have been etched in you on the pathway to your promise. But sometimes you have to stop and deal with the things that have happened to you in your season of development. Yeah, some of you don't understand how you are functioning in a season of success, but there's still some dysfunction that's reigning on the inside of you. Because you can get to things that shimmer, shine, and glimmer, but you have not dealt with the innermost problems that you need to really deal with. And so while people are celebrating you, you need to examine yourself. You need to look internally and understand what it took for you to get where you are. Sometimes we don't pause and pay attention to the places that we've been damaged. Sometimes we don't pause and pay attention to the things that can derail and destruct the thing that we have only dreamed about. But we have to look back and analyze the pits of life. Just nudge your neighbor and tell them, look at your pit. Yeah, look at your pit. You gotta learn to examine the pits that you've been through. Again, it's easy to celebrate that you're finally in Pharaoh's house, but if you don't examine the days that you spent in the pit, then you will take some of the pit into Pharaoh's house. Some of y'all are in Pharaoh's house, but still got some pit living on the inside of you. Have you ever been in the place that you desired to be in, only to discover that you still got some pit on the inside of you? Amen. You speak in tongues, but you still cuss a little bit. Amen. Now you can't say that in church because you want everybody to believe that you saved, sanctified,
sanctified and full of the Holy Ghost, but some of us are discovering that there's still some pit on the inside of us. I can pray for you and cut you after I get done, amen, and then pray you into your right place. You ain't gonna be honest, but some of us still got a little pit on the inside of us. Can you just tell your neighbor, don't play with me, amen. You better pray for me, but don't play with me, because I still got some pit on the inside of me. I'm in the right place, but I still got some wrong stuff on the inside of me. I have not been fully processed yet. You see me functioning in my capacity, but I could still kill you quicker than look at you. Y'all they gonna help me up in here, but some of us can be honest and tell your neighbor, amen, I'm not a killer, but don't push me. Amen. Just nudge your neighbor and tell him you sat next to somebody that still got a little pit on the inside of them. And I know that the pit was purposeful, but it was also painful. And anybody in here can be honest and say that you have not fully gotten over some of your pit experiences. I mean, you are fully functioning in everything that you dreamed about, but there's something about what you've been through that still got a hold on you. Look at somebody and tell them deliverance is in the room today. And baby, I don't care how saved, how sanctified you are, there's some stuff that you got to look back over and say, God, get it out of me. Amen, somebody. Look at somebody and tell them, God, get it out of me. There's some things that are compromising you. There are some things that you're still dealing with. There's some things that happened in Potiphar's house. And yes, it was a season of preparation, but it was also purgatory for many of us. It was a place that while people thought we had it going on, there were some things that were going on inside the scenario and the circumstance that was radically altering our life. It's the prison that is positional, but it's also problematic. And many of us, that's our testimony this morning. We're out, but we're injured. Yeah, it'll catch up with you on the way home. Some of you don't understand that you can be out of a thing and that thing still be on the inside of you. Thank you for your honesty. Is there anybody that ever discovered that you came out of it, but some of it was still on the inside of you? And people look at you in your season of celebration, but they don't know what happened to you in your season of isolation. They don't understand the places that you were injured. Look at somebody and tell them, I look good, but I got some damage on the inside of me. Oh, and until you own that and until you're honest with yourself about that, you're going to keep compromising everything that God placed you in. Somebody lift up your hands and say, God, deal with my damage. Some of y'all are like Mephibosheth. You are at the king's table, and even though the king can't look up under the table, you are still profoundly aware that the feet that are up under the table are still deformed and damaged, because God don't have to fix your feet in order to bless your life. Some of you are functioning with deformed feet while you're sitting at the king's table. Is there anybody that can be honest and say that I look good from the waist up, but if you could see what's up under the table, I know God got it covered, but I'm still compromised by it. Somebody ought to lift up your hands and shout, God, deal with it. Oh, come on, open up your mouth and shout, God, deal with it. If I could just get a little bottom in these mics. So like Mephibosheth, we are sitting. Please be seated in the presence of God. We are seated at the king's table, but we are still dealing with places that are misshaped and malformed. We're still dealing with the days that we've been dropped. And even though we are seated in heavenly places, we are still struggling with carnal realities that are keeping us grounded. But I thank God that Bishop is teaching that there is now, therefore, no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. Somebody ought to just lift up your hands and say, there's no shame on me. And I need you to recognize that today. And I need you to grab a hold to that. And I need you to gain a greater understanding, because there are some days that people celebrate the battles that you've won. And we celebrate the life of Samson and the places that he defeated the lion with his bare hands. But we don't recognize the days that Samson still smelled the breath of the lion breathing down his back. We don't recognize the stripes on his back from the paw of the lion that he wrestled with and fought with. Isn't it just like people to flip the page of your life and skip your process and look at you in your season of success and believe that it's always been that way? But the devil is a lie. You need to tell somebody, I don't look like what I've been through, but it still don't mean that I ain't been through something. Don't you ever get it twisted and not factor in the stuff that I had to face to get where I am. So when you see me shouting and praising and dancing and running around the church, it's not because I got everything that I'm praising for. It's because of the stuff that I made it through. And I'm going to give you about 5 seconds to open up your mouth and give God a praise for the stuff that your neighbor don't know that you made it through. Can you take a moment and testify with the sound of your mouth and let every principality and power know that I've been through something, but I'm still here by the grace of God? Clap your hands and give God praise. Thank you for your honesty. You look so good. We'd never know that you had been through anything, because there's something about God that when he dresses you, when he gives you a ring, a robe, and a chain, it's easy to forget the pits, the Potiphar's houses, and the prisons that people have been through. And so I'll never judge your praise ever again, because I don't know what your praise costs you. Some of y'all sit up in here and look at people like they're crazy when they praising God, but some of us need to join in and celebrate with them, because I don't know the price that you paid to push that praise up out of you. I don't know where those tears came from. I don't know where that dance came from, but every now and then when somebody runs, you need to run with them. Some of y'all watch this woman of God run around this room by herself, but somebody should have joined in and ran with her, because sometimes I got to partner with you, because I don't know the pits that you came through. I don't know the prisons that God saved you from, but I just want to partner with you and give God a quick praise. Can you partner with somebody in this room and give God a praise for the stuff that you didn't even know that they were dealing with? I'm sorry that I walked past you without asking you, is everything okay? Because you may be praising through a problem, but I want to partner with you and I want to lift up a sound of praise and let you know that you went through that by yourself, but you ain't going to have to go through the next season by yourself. Look at somebody and tell them you got a partner in praise. Oh no, do better than that. Tell somebody around you, you got a partner in praise. Please be seated. So what was designated and designed to develop us gets in us. I never will forget Pastor Travis, a good friend of mine. He and his wife were expecting a baby boy, and I was waiting for the news that he had been born, and time went past and I didn't hear from him. And so eventually I ended up calling him because expectation got the best of me. I said, man, what's going on, man? I haven't heard from you. Is your son in the earth yet, man? He said, look, G, I need you to pray, man. I said, what's going on? He said, man, when Timberland was coming out, he inhaled when he should have exhaled. And what he had been in for 9 months got on the inside of him. What was good in developing him on the outside got in him when he was coming out. Amen. Tell somebody coming out can compromise you. Some of us sitting up in here today have inhaled when we should have exhaled, and the thing that was designed to develop us is now inside of us, destroying us. Look at somebody and tell them, God is going to help you breathe again. There's some stuff that got in you that never should have got on the inside of you. Nudge your neighbor and tell them, it was only designed to develop you, but it never should have got inside of you, because what's on the outside is good as long as you keep it there. But when it gets on the inside, it can compromise everything that God desired to develop you in. Look at somebody and tell them, it was only supposed to develop you. Y'all better help me preach. I said, talk to your neighbor and tell them, it was only designed to develop you. Baby, you got to get that bitterness up out of you. There's some blessings that God is trying to get on your life, that blessings and burdens can't fit in the same package. Look at somebody and tell them, today in the name of Jesus. No, put your preaching voice on and say, in the name of Jesus. That thing coming out of you, that thing that's been compromising you, that thing that's got you crying in the middle of the night, that thing that's got you pacing the floor, not your neighbor and tell them, today is the last. Y'all ain't preaching. I said, preach to them and tell them, today is the last day. Tell somebody else, you're going to live. And you will not die. No, I need you to speak it like you got faith. Nudge your neighbor and tell them, live. I know you've been through some difficult stuff. I know you've had some stuff damage you. I know that you had some stuff that you wish you hadn't been through. Look at somebody and tell them, but it was good for me. Y'all ain't gonna help me preach. Tell somebody, it was good for me that I had been afflicted. It was good for me that I've been through the pit. It was good for me. Look at somebody and tell them, it was good for me. You gonna sit up in here and act like it took you out? The devil is a liar. After all you've been through, look at somebody and tell them, I'm still here. Y'all ain't preaching. I said, preach to your neighbor and tell him, I'm still here. Tell him, I'm still here. Been developed in the dark. Been developed in the dirt. Been developed in the dung. But I'm still here. On your way down, tell somebody, I'm still here. I'm still here. Sometimes you can change clothes and you can change positions, and sometimes you can change your dress, and sometimes you can change your whip, and sometimes the crowd is cheering but they don't understand what it costs. Amen. Tell somebody, every cheer costs something. Some of y'all want the platform and you want the shine and you want the shimmer and you want all the trimmings and the trappings, but just remind somebody and tell them, it costs something. It costs something. And I would have thought that I would have got a little bit better praise, because there's some accomplished, successful people in this house, and I need you to testify to every person that's trying to make it where you are, and I need you to give God a praise for the price that you paid to be you. No, I need you to do just a little bit better than that. I need you to celebrate what you've been through. I need you to open up your mouth and give God a good praise and tell him, thank you, Lord, thank you that you kept me, thank you that I did not lose my mind, thank you that I'm still able to lift up my hands and still bless your. Where the praise is at. Look at somebody and tell them, praise costs something. Don't you ever be casual with your praise. Look at your neighbor and tell them, this next praise costs me some friends. This next praise costs me some days by myself. This next praise took me through hell and high water. But because I made it through, I'm going to lift up my hands and open up my mouth and say, thank you, Jesus. Somebody lift up your voice and give God a praise. In spite of the stuff that tried to take it, in spite of the thing that's trying to tell you, you ain't got no reason. The devil is a liar. When I don't have a reason, I got a right to praise the Lord. Look at somebody and tell them, exercise your rights. I'm just trying to see where some people are that have paid the price. I'm trying to see where some people are that are still pushing. Look at somebody and tell them, but I still got a praise. That's how I know God is real. The pit didn't take my praise. Potiphar's house didn't take my praise. The prison didn't take my praise. Look at somebody and tell them, I still got it. I still got it. Y'all ain't moving, running. Somebody and tell them, I still got it. Lost some stuff, but I'm still leaping. Been through some difficulty, but I'm still dancing. You wonder why I praise him? Because he kept my mind. Tell somebody around you, he's a keeper. He's a keeper. He's a keeper. He's a keeper. If you wondering why I'm shouting, it's because he's a keeper. It's not because everything has been wonderful. It's because when I thought I was going to die, he lifted me up. Somebody shout. Tell somebody, I've been through some stuff. If you knew my story, you would shout for me. I said, if you knew my story, you would shout for me. Look at somebody and tell them, I've been through the storm and the rain. Y'all ain't talking. I said, talk to your neighbor and tell them, oh, neighbor. Tell them, I've been through the storm and the rain. But I'm still here. I'm still here. I'm still here. Y'all ain't moving, moving. Touch somebody and tell them, still here, still, still, still here. You ain't praising like you've been through nothing. You ain't praising like you survived something. Before you celebrate where I am, you better praise God for my process. Oh, look at somebody and tell them, praise them for your process. No, tell somebody, praise them for your process. Praise them for the stuff you lost. Praise them for the days that you wanted to give up. Praise them for the days that you wanted to die. But you squared your shoulders, lifted up your hands, and said, here am I, Lord. Somebody say, yeah. Somebody clap your hands like you're glad to be here. Somebody clap your hands like life ain't been no crystal stair. But you kept on stepping. You kept on putting one foot in front of the other. Look at somebody and tell them, I mastered waking up. Baby, I'm no better than you. I just learned how to trust in Jesus. Anybody trusting in the Lord? Reach up and down your row and tell your neighbor, keep trusting, keep trusting, keep trusting, keep trusting. No, tell somebody, keep trusting, keep. I need you to point your prophetic finger at somebody and tell them, hold on. I wish I had some people in the Potter's house, North Dallas, that felt like preaching. Point your prophetic finger at your neighbor and tell him, hold on, just a little while longer. Everything gonna be all right. Look at somebody and tell them, sooner or later, it's getting ready to turn in your favor. Look at somebody and tell them, I dare you to turn. I double dog dare you to turn. I dare you to make every principality and power know that after all you took me through, greater is he. I thought I had some praises up in the house. Run to three people and tell them, greater is he. The pit didn't factor in, my God. Potiphar's wife didn't factor in, God. The prison didn't factor in, God. But when God made you a promise, look at somebody and tell them, all I praise and offer is a promise from the Lord. Some of y'all ain't praising because you got it. Some of you are praising because God promised it. Look at somebody and tell them, God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. For if the Lord said it, anybody can testify and tell your neighbor he will do just what he said. If he gotta take you through hell and high water, he'll still do what he said. If he gotta let everybody walk out and leave you for dead, he'll still do what he said. Look at somebody and tell them they didn't leave you to die, they left you to live. Look at somebody and tell them, I made up in my mind, I'm gonna live. Y'all better help me preach. Run to three people and tell them, live, live, live. No, run to somebody and tell them, live. Run to somebody else and tell them, live. Baby, you're about to put your grave clothes up, and you're about to live in the name of Jesus. Look at somebody and tell them, I got my mind made up. I'm gonna live anyhow, and God gonna bless me even better. Look at somebody and tell them, double blessing. No, as a matter of fact, I hear the Holy Ghost say, good measure, pressed down, shaken together. Look at somebody and tell them, you're about to run over. No, tell them, you're about to run over. And I came to tell the Potter's House, North Dallas, that I hear babies crying. Somebody ought to run to your neighbor and tell them, you're about to give birth. After all that you've been through, God says that he's about to bring something out of you greater than the thing that you've been through. Can somebody run to your neighbor and say, oh neighbor, God is about to blow your mind for everything that you thought that you were going to die in. Look at somebody and tell them, I speak a Manessa over you. Y'all better help me preach. I said, run to somebody and say, oh neighbor, you get ready to birth your Vanessa. God is about to make you forget how bad it was. God is about to make you forget all the hell that you went through. You ought to prophesy to your neighbor and tell them, for every broken place, God is about to bless you so crazy you're about to forget that you were ever broken. Somebody ought to give God a praise for every tear you've cried. He's about to give you the spirit of joy. He's about to give you a garment of praise. Look up and down your row and say, neighbor, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I'm looking at some Mephibosheths in the room. Look at somebody and tell them, my feet may be broken, but I still got a blessing on my life, and God can put you at a table to where your feet don't even matter no more. Look at somebody and tell them, oh neighbor, no, grab them by the hand, shake them like you got the Holy Ghost, shake them up out of their pit of despair, shake them and rock them and shake them. Can I preach like I'm at the river? I said, shake that neighbor like you pulling them up out of that rut, like you pulling them up out of that despair. And after all that you've been through, you owe God this next praise, because this next praise says that things are about to get better. You ought to give God a shout like it's about to get, it's about to get better. You've cried too many nights for it to end this way. Run to somebody and say, neighbor, it won't be this way. Always. Y'all acting like y'all ain't got no expectation. But I need you to find a praise partner and say, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Is there anybody in this Potter's House, North Dallas, that came to lift up a praise? I dare you to lift up a praise greater than the hell that you've been through. I dare you to lift up a sound greater than the stuff that you've been through. I dare you to let every principality and power know that I'm not easily broken. I could have died right there, but I'm still standing by the grace of God. I'd have messed around and preached myself happy. I need you to run to somebody and say everything on this road is about to give God a ridiculous praise. If you need to get out of here, you can put your Baptist finger up and you can leave the room right now. But I need somebody that's got some scars on them, that's got some wounds on them, that's got some difficulties that you've been through, to just open up your mouth and give God a praise. I need you to give God a praise. I need you to give God a praise. I need you to open up your mouth, Zion, and give God your best praise. I need you to lay your head back and let every demon and devil know that when you go back to the pit, I'm not going to be there. When you go back to Potiphar's house, I'm not going to be there. When you go back to the prison, I'm not going to be there. You ought to just switch places with somebody sitting next to you and tell them the next place that your ex comes to look for you in, I prophesy that you won't be there. The next place that the old boss comes looking for you, I come to prophesy over you and tell you you won't be there. The next time grief comes looking for you, I came to tell you you won't be there. You ought to just move positions with somebody and tell them next time it looks for me, I won't be there. Can I get somebody in this house to just walk around the room? There's a prophetic announcement that says you won't be in the last place they left you. You won't be in the last place that they left you to die. Somebody ought to give God a praise and shout, I won't be there. Good evening now, y'all. I got to go back to Durham, but I just came to tell somebody, you about to switch positions. Y'all better just do it one more time. Look at somebody and tell them, switch. No, y'all still ain't doing it. Tell somebody switch. It's about to get better. Look at somebody and tell them switch. It's about to be worth it. Look at somebody and tell them switch. God's about to make you glad. As a matter of fact, the devil been trying to steal your praise. But I need you to look at everything that tried to kill you. I need you to look at everything that tried to stop you. And I need you to give God a praise. Come on, lift up a sound. A sound says, I'm still alive. Still alive. And if I'm still alive, my dream is still alive. Somebody ought to give God a praise and shout, it's still alive. Everything that you prayed for is still alive. Everything that you've been believing for is still alive. I need you to prophesy to your neighbor and tell him it's still alive. Come on, tell somebody it's still alive, it's still alive. Baby, you can sit up in here and look sad, but I dare you to let the joy of the Lord be your strength. Sometimes it's not the journey that's joyful, but sometimes it's just I'm satisfied with Jesus. Can somebody lift up a shout? Tell somebody around you, I'm still alive, I'm still alive. Tell them it ain't been easy, but it will be worth it. Come on, tell somebody it ain't been easy, but it will be worth it. Come on, tell somebody else it hasn't been easy, but it will be worth it. Woo.
Everybody hear me. Tell somebody else it hasn't been easy, but it will be worth it. Come on, clap those hands like you know it. Diamond that's precious. It's the process. It's not the gold that's precious. It's the process. Whenever you see somebody in their season, don't envy them, because you don't have a clue what it's cost them. Just tell somebody, you don't have a clue what it costs you. Some of y'all look at the cost . Better yet, let me say it like this. Some of you look at the price, but you don't understand the cost. We're in the middle of a new building project, and people look at the price, but Pastor Joseph, they don't know the cost. And when we move in our new plush palatial 21st century worship center, people will come and celebrate, and they will look at the price, but they'll never know the cost. Tell your neighbor, you may understand the price, you'll just never know the cost. And as they watch Joseph robed and ringed and being celebrated, very few of them knew the betrayal of his brothers. They didn't understand the betrayal of Miss Potiphar. They didn't understand the prison that he was forgotten in. And so as God is taking you to higher heights, and I'm prophesying over you right now, as God does greater things in you, don't get so caught up in the roar of the crowd that you forget to stop and deal with the things that got in you as you were being processed. If you're in this room today and you can say, Bishop, I got some stuff and we're almost done. I got some stuff that I got to deal with. I want you to make a sign and a signal in the earth by just coming quickly to this altar, quickly from wherever you are. I got some stuff that I know I got to deal with before I get to where God has taken me, before God does in me what I know that he has designed for me to do. I got to deal with some things today. I got to process some of the pain. I've got to deal with some of the difficulty, because just because they put a ring and a robe and a chain on you don't mean that you're healthy and don't mean that you're whole. As we look deeper into the text and as we go on in the life of Joseph, we see that he's still got some unresolved issues, because there's still some Jacob in the Joseph. Still some stuff from his father that he's wrestling with. Still some damage, not only in the things that he's been through, but in the DNA that he carries. sometimes it's your DNA that compromises your dream. And sometimes it's the things that you've been through that when you get to the thing that you've been dreaming about, it compromises it. Because you can kill giants, you can kill and conquer situations and circumstances, but until David, you deal with the Goliath in you. The reason David is so good at killing giants is because he had so many giants living in him. This one you gotta do. This one ain't no pastors gonna lay their hands on you. This one is not about emotionalism. This is about your opportunity to finally deal with the pits, the Potiphar's houses, and the prisons. You've been moving so swiftly, you haven't processed it. God flipped the pages in your life so quickly that you never took time to deal with it. And some of you are preaching, but you're still processing. Some of you worshiping, but you're still worried about that thing that's wrestling with you on the inside of you. Some of us are still warring. People see you and they're like, ooh, I want to be her. I want to be him. But they don't have a clue what that would cost them. While you're at this altar, I want you to lift up your hands. I want you to start working it out. Audibly. Openly. God's about to give you your Manasseh. If you're still in the chairs, it means you've already worked yours out, so there's an authority and an anointing on you to where you ought to be helping these who are at this altar win. I see Pastor Travis preaching every Sunday, but I don't know what it cost him. Pray. I see that oil on Pastor Tina's life, but I don't know what it cost him. Pray. I see Pastor Joseph, but I really don't know what that oil cost him. Pray. Come on, audibly, open. Put your voice in the room. Put your voice in the room. You can't birth a Manasseh until you put a seed in a womb. God brought you to this altar because this altar is a womb for you to plant the seed to birth your Manasseh. God, help me forget. I got my dream job, but the molestation that happened to me still keeps coming up. Help me forget. I got the dream salary, but that divorce is still devouring me. God, help me forget. Come on, open up your mouths. Ruske tebeshe katara. Romance ke tebeshe. Come on, open up your mouths. Come on, plant that seed. Wipe it away, God. Take it out of me. The thing that keeps coming back up. The grief that has a grip on me that just won't let go of me. Give me my Manasseh today. Ooh. I'm working and don't nobody even know what I'm wrestling with. I'm doing and don't nobody even know what I'm dealing with. My spouse don't even know how I'm struggling and how I'm pushing. But today, God, I need my Manasseh. Come on, well out of your belly. Cry out to your God.
Plant that seed today in the name of Jesus. God, give me my Manessa. Ooh. I know it's got to get better. I can't just get to this place, God. I still remember when my brothers betrayed me. I can't get to this place, and I still have nightmares while everybody else is believing that I'm living my dream. I need you to work today, God. Go deep inside, God. Get the place that I don't share with anybody. Reach the place that I don't talk about to anybody. Reach the place, God, that's broken into a million pieces and put the fragments back together again. God, do it today, God. Do it, do it. Oh, I'm dressed up, God, but I got a mess going on the inside of me. Do it, God. Do it, God. Do it. Do it, God. Do it, God. Do it, God. Do it, God. Do it. Everybody lift your hands. I declare and decree over you that today your Manessa comes. Memories that were overwhelming, things that kept you paralyzed, even though you were performing well, things that kept compromising you, I declare and decree that God is birthing something in you today. And not too many months from now, you'll be bouncing that blessing on your knee. And it will outweigh everything that you've cried through. It will outweigh everything that you pushed through. It will outweigh everything that you sacrifice through. Can you just hug your neighbor while you're at this altar, while you're headed back to your seat? Tell them, get ready to bounce your baby on your knee. Get ready to welcome the thing that will wipe away all the bad memories. God has a way of giving you spiritual amnesia. He can bless you so good, you'll forget what you went through. Amen. Everybody hear me as you're making your way back to your seat. Everyone standing on your feet. I want you to hear this. I want you to hear this. We're getting ready to go. I'm getting ready to give this mic to my sister Lana. And I'm getting ready to get out of here. Everybody hear me. I was just with Bishop and Pastor a few weeks ago. And man, I was in a difficult place. Nobody knew it. I was dressed to the nines. You know, I love my clothes. Amen. That's just who I am. Drip is my friend. Amen. Man, I was swagged out. Walked up in the room. People thought I had it going on. Man, I was in the fight of my life. I had $1 million debt hanging over my head that had to be solved by the end of the week. I had deadlines that I needed to meet. And this particular place that we were at, they asked me to do the offering segment. And I said, I reached over to Bishop. I said, man, this morning, what did you ask the people to give? He told me. And the Holy Spirit told me that there was supernatural acceleration on the seed that he said. And it was a $318 seed. But man, I was so desperate and I was in such need. God told me to make my seed $3,180. And I did. By the time that next week was over, all of that debt was gone. Saul. Something about when you move at the word of the man of God. Everybody hear me. There are 10 people in this place. I don't want you to come to the altar. I don't want you to be pulled out as a spectacle, because what you're dealing with is a private pain that nobody knows but you. I want you to release a radical faith today. And I want you, those 10 people, I want you to sow that $3,180 seed. I don't want you to do this by way of envelope. I want you to do it secretly. Everybody hear me. I want you to do it secretly. You don't need fanfare. You don't need notoriety. You don't need nobody to know your name. You just need God to move swiftly in your situation. And if I'm talking to you, I want you to sow that seed.
to the rest of you, I want you to muster up your faith, and I want us to partner with the seed that the man of God spoke, and there was a $318 seed. I want you to sow that, and we're going to do that collectively. Now, together, we will raise our hands. I want you to get your envelopes, amen. And now, collectively, I want you to get your envelopes, and we're going to collectively sow. We're going to collectively sow. If you're going to step in faith and sow that $318 seed, I want you to lift your hands. I want you to lift your hands. I believe in seed time harvest. I am a product of giving. Everything that I have is because of what I've given. Places that I've sacrificed, places that I've sowed is where God has blessed me in every sacrificial place. Just lift your hands. They'll give you the envelope. I want us to sow collectively. And I want us to sow together. I want us to sow collectively, and I want us to sow together. Amen. Praise God. Some of you are giving by way of your phone. Thank you for your obedience. We're going to do this collectively. Those of you who are watching me by way of streaming, I want you to join us. You are just as near there as you are here, and this word is resonating with you. I want you to sow your seed. I want you to sow your seed. I want you to sow your seed. To those of you who want to join in this moment, you want to sow with us, amen. You can say, Bishop, I don't have that, but my faith is speaking that, amen. My faith is speaking that. I want you to slip your hand up. I want them to get an envelope in your hand, but collectively we're going to give together. Collectively we're going to give together. Collectively we're going to give together, amen. Praise God. I thank God that I believe the words of my bishop and I believe the words of my pastor. When they speak a word, I put my faith on what they said. And today I'm a living product of just believing in the principles that the man and woman of God preach and teach to me. And man, I live out of it every day. I'm so grateful that I get to live in the inheritance that they have left to me and to my family. And I am just overwhelmed with the opportunity for them to just plant and deposit into my life. Amen. All of us should be giving together. If you're giving, let us stand. Let us stand. Amen. Let us stand collectively and let us stand as a unified people. Lana's going to come and she's going to finish receiving our offering. Amen. And we love you guys. I am so grateful for you. Thank you for putting up with my foolishness and my folly called preaching. I appreciate you guys. You are amazing. I love y'all. Keep praying for the river. We've got some tight deadlines. We got to move into our new building by June, and we will do it if the Potter's House North Dallas is praying for us. Will y'all pray for us? Amen. I said, will y'all pray for us? Amen. We are just simply the smaller version of y'all. Amen. Everything y'all do, we duplicate. Amen. So this is the big D with a little D, and we're just trying to duplicate what y'all are doing, but y'all are absolutely amazing. I love y'all. Please tell Pastor that I did okay. Will y'all do that for me? I love you guys. God bless you.
Y'all, put your hands together for our Bishop Big Brother, Ronald Godbee. We love you, Bishop, and we will commit to praying for him as well as the river. What a word. That was a prophetic word today. Everybody should have been able to take something and grab a hold of that. I took a hold of the line when he said, the miracles happen in the messy moments. Sometimes we try to go so hard to get out of the messy moments, but sometimes when we will submit to that process, that's when miracles are birthed. Amen. Amen. If you're giving and you're sowing a seed today, you can continue to do that on your phone, on your devices. You can also use the envelopes, like we said, in the back of the chair. You can bring that forward. And we want to thank you today for that seed that is being sown. I have a few announcements, and then we're going to head on out. We have Wednesday night life class with our own Bishop Brady and his lovely co-host, Pastor Sheryl Brady. They are the dynamic duo, and we are so grateful for those nights of just sitting. It's more intimate. If you have never been here before on a Wednesday night, starts at 6:45. We want to encourage you to be in the building. It is a great family moment. It's kind of like the family side fire chats. It is just a really great night to be here. All the singles in the house, we y'all going bowling. Bowling, bowling, bowling at Penn Stack on March 31st in Allen from 7 to 9 p.m. There is a QR code. You got to scan that QR code to register. April 1st, we have First Saturday Prayer is back. Amen. Who's going to be in the house for First Saturday Prayer? We have prayer at 7 a.m. and then we have Fit Fam. Come on, Marin, Fit Fam. Happening at 8:30 a.m. right after. All right, y'all know Todd Galbert is coming to us. Amen. We're going to have an amazing night with him. If you have, if anybody got your tickets yet, raise your hand. You got your tickets yet? I see y'all. Go online either to tphnd.org and get your tickets, or you can go directly to his website. If you use the TPHND15 coupon code, you can catch 15% off of them tickets. So get your tickets. It's going to be an amazing night. And Saturday, April 8th, from 11 to 1, I told y'all this last week, our Easter egg hunt extravaganza is back. We are going to have an amazing time. We got food, inflatables, caricature artists. It's a family event. It's a family affair. No, I'm just kidding. I'm not singing. Bring your kids out. Bring your grandkids out, nieces, nephews, all of the adults. It's a family church event, so it is not just for kids. We have a lot of fun. We've got some games for the adults. We got great giveaways. And then the very next day is Easter Sunday. Somebody say two services. Now remember this, we're changing it. So it is 8 a.m. and 10 p.m. 8 a.m. and 10 p.m. The 8 a.m. Oh, that's sorry. It's not 10 p.m. We are not coming back for 10 p.m. service. We're going to be asleep. 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. The 8 a.m. service is a family service, so there is no Firehouse or Northside Kids. 10 a.m., they will be open, rocking, ready to go, having a great time, so do not miss out on Easter Sunday. Also, I want you to turn your attention to the screens for just a moment, and we are going to check out a video real quick about our Engage event that is coming up.
I intended to engage last year because I was just curious. The concept of serving was kind of new to me, so it was just an opportunity for me to understand kind of what is expected, what happens behind the scenes, and how does everything work at the church. I thought the experience was high energy, it was fun, it was engaging, it was just an opportunity to learn more about people who are at the church and what they do. And I signed up for the special events team, but since they only meet as needed, I was asked to serve in the volunteer services, and I've been serving ever since. I love being a servant leader because it gives you the opportunity to meet new people, build community, and also feel like you're connected to the vision of God's house through the servant leadership that you have. I would encourage anyone to attend Engage and become a servant leader because it gives you the opportunity to grow as a leader, connect with the team, and also be part of the TPHND family.
Yes, this is our great weekend that we have with Dr. Jamone Glenn, y'all. He's coming back. He's coming back to teach us, to love on us, to share with us. That is, again, April 15th. Get your phones out. Y'all need to scan that QR code, register, register. This is for all servant leaders and anyone that is interested in becoming a part of a department in this church and being a part of this servant leader family. We are going to have a great time that weekend, and we are going to have food. Lunch will be provided because y'all know around here we work for food, right, Kevin? We work for food in family ministry and in the parking lot team, anywhere. If there's donuts or Chick-fil-A, we will work for food, okay? So we are going to have a great event, and I want you guys to please register for that. And we also have Pastor Brady's birthday celebration is coming up April 16th. The very next Sunday with Dr. Jamone Glenn. He is going to be here on that Sunday with us as well. So everybody standing on your feet, we're going to go before the Lord in prayer. I want to encourage you to remember to continue to please pray for the families that have been affected in Mississippi. We have people right here in our sanctuary that have been affected. They have family members that our houses are destroyed. They're trying to still locate them. Even during service, I just was notified by text that there was one of our members here, his cousin's wife,
was killed in the tornadoes. And so that affects, that's close to home, y'all. So let's continue to have our hearts stirred and ask God to cover them as they begin their repairing process and even just in their grief, because they are going to have grief dealing with this. So let's just be sensitive to praying for that community, all right? Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for what that you have done for us, for how you have filled us up and fed us today, God, until overflow, God. We thank you, God, that we will be good stewards over the word that you've given us, God, that we continue, God, to work this word throughout our week and into our lives, into our families, God. We thank you that you go before us, that you surround us, that you guide us, God, that you're protecting us, that you protect our kids, that you protect our schools, God. We thank you that absolutely no weapon that's trying to be formed against them shall prosper in the name of Jesus. We cover them with the blood, God. We cover them and surround them, God, that there will be no distraction, God, but that you will go before them, God, that you will cover them and surround them. In Jesus' name, we ask you, God, to go into our week, to teach us what we need to be taught. Open up our eyes, God. Open up our ears, God. Help us to be sensitive to the needs of those that are around us, God. And while we are out there in our community and in our homes and in our workplaces and in our schools, that when they look upon us, that they will see you in us. Somebody say, shine, Lord. We love you, Potter's House North family. Be blessed. Have the best week ever. We love you. Ministers that are here, if anyone needs a special touch, a hug, a prayer, we want you to know that our ministers are